Almighty God, we have heard your words to us in Holy Scripture and know your call to each of us. In every age you have spoken through the voices of prophets, pastors, and teachers. We give you thanks that over the years we have heard you speak to us through the preaching of your word in this place. Grant that those who preach in this place may proclaim the crucified and risen Christ and interpret your word with sensitivity and insight, that we may hear that word inwardly and respond to it in all our life. This we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, your living word. Amen.
That promise that there would be a time when someone who would come
who would rule with righteousness. Oh my goodness, don't we long for that? Don't we long for someone who will rule in our lives and in our world with peace, with justice, with compassion? Every time we have an election, we think we found that person, at least for a little while. And then we discover that like us, they have clay feet. And like us, they cannot be perfect. It's impossible. And sometimes we look around and see people in leadership who we are deadly afraid of because of the ways in which they lead and the lack of care for their own people. But Isaiah envisions this time when the wolf shall lie down with the lamb, when the leopard shall lie down with the kid, the calf and the fatling, and the lion and the fatling together, and a little child will lead them. This vision that seems absolutely impossible, that the animals of the natural world that are normally enemies might possibly lie down together. Is this actually a real vision or is it imaginary? But at least it draws our hearts by saying this will be a time of peace for all. And it is something we long for. And Isaiah says it will come when the root of Jesse, when a branch will rise from, a shoot will come from the stump of Jesse, a branch will grow out of his roots. And so Isaiah foresees this in a particular person. And I'm sure that as every king rose in the time of Israel and Judah, there was a longing for this to be the one that Isaiah had promised. And none of them were. For Christians, we look back and we say, this sounds like a description of Jesus, the one who will come from the stump of Jesse, the one who will come from David's line, the one who will bring that peace. And yet, when you think about it, Jesus came, and peace has not yet come. So if Jesus rules, why are we still waiting? Why has that peace, why has that vision of that kingdom not been fully realized? And there is no answer to that, except that Christ promised to come again and calls us to live faithfully in the meantime. So we live standing at that threshold, standing in that liminal space, standing there waiting, patiently, waiting, waiting, waiting. And the question becomes, how then will we wait? And we see some inklings of that in both the passage in Romans and in John the Baptist's cry. John, that brash, strident voice in the wilderness, who says the answer to that is repentance. Repentance. Now we can hear John's voice and just simply feel guilty. There's lots for us to be guilty about, for every one of us. Bishops and women fall short. Every one of us has broken one of the commandments. Has broken one of those seven deadly sins. Greed, lust, jealousy, envy, anger. Any of those have been part of our lives at some time or other. And John's cry of repentance hits us hard, but I hope we hear that the word repentance is not just about feeling guilty. To repent is not simply to feel sorry and stay there. No. To repent is to literally turn around, to change, to say, I choose to live differently. It is to remember that every time we come back to that place where we know we've fallen short, we stop and say, what do I need to do so that doesn't happen again? Or so that I work on that part of my life and my soul so that I live more consistently in the gospel. And so as we stand at that threshold, we'll call first to that constant life of repentance. Whenever you fall into sin, is our baptismal promise. Whenever you fall into sin, not if, when you fall into sin, will you repent and return to the Lord? And we said yes, with God's help. And so that's the first step. And the second is that it was reminded in Romans, Paul writes, for whatever was written in former days was written for our instruction, so that by steadfastness and by encouragement of the scriptures we might hope. Now, I don't get to very many movies. My schedule doesn't seem to allow it very often. But I happen to see a trailer for the movie that's coming out very shortly called Rogue One, which is the prequel to Star Wars. Now, I like Star Wars. So I was watching the trailer. And the trailer is about the startup of the Empire. And there's a line that one of the characters says when somebody says, what can we possibly do to defeat the Empire? We are lost. And the character says, no, we are not, because we have hope. It is hope that is the greatest power in the world. And St. Paul says that we got that hope because we see in Scripture what God has done for us in the past, and we see it because the God of steadfastness and encouragement, God is steadfastness and encouragement, can give us what we need to live in harmony with one another, in accordance with Jesus Christ, so that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. And our passage today finished with that wonderful acclamation we sometimes use at the end of our worship. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. For that is what will take us through this liminal time of the threshold. Of that threshold between what God has done in the past and what God is doing now and will do in that second coming of Christ. That threshold between our past and our future when we stand at that moment of repentance. That threshold between all that God has promised and its fulfillment. And that threshold for the church, because frankly, we stand in challenging times for our church. When this church was built, it was built because it needed the space. It needed more pews, more space for all those who were coming to worship. As we came through the 50s and 60s, our churches were full and overflowing. Our Sunday schools had hundreds in them. The baby boom was on. And we thought that's what the church was meant to look like all the time. And it has changed. For a whole variety of reasons, many of them outside our control. And we now have many churches that are much less full than they were 50 years ago. And there is a cry of, what now, O God? What has happened? Why can't we get back to that time when the AYPA, when the Sunday schools were full? And there's no quick answer to that question. And so as we stand at this threshold, we're also asked, how will you then live in the steadfastness and encouragement of the hope of God in Jesus Christ? How will you stand at that threshold and tell the good news that God has come? That God forgives, that God's love is stronger than any power on earth, and that your lives are different because God is with you. And that's what we're called to do as we stand at this threshold, to tell the good news, to share it with neighbors, to share it with friends, to share it because it wells up as a joy within us. That we just have to tell. We share it with our actions by reaching out in God's love and compassion. We share it in our advocacy for justice for our brothers and sisters in this world. We share it in the small things as the casserole that goes to the neighbor who's sick, the visit of the person who's struggling. It is in the hope and the joy and the love we share because of Jesus Christ. None of us knows what the future will hold. But our call is to live with that kind of courage and and steadfast joy so that people have a chance to see the love of Christ in us. And that they have a chance to choose it for themselves. Standing at thresholds is exciting, as opportunities before us. It's also scary. We don't know what's coming. But we stand there absolutely certain that we stand there with others, and we stand there with God. We stand there with God's joy, with God's Spirit, and with the presence of Christ with us and in us. And what more could we ask? May we have courage to live into all that is coming, because we go with God, in the power of God, in the love of God. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Amen.